we are from Waag Society, and we do the same thing. We try to dissect technology and try to understand what it does for society, mainly what values does it have, and also how it shapes and affects society, and what we can do to appropriate it. Today, it's about democracy. And well, representative democracy has been around for quite a few years, ages, I'd say. And it did not change that much. But during the time of the internet that we are now, somehow things changed quite dramatically. And new ways of participating in government, new ways of using technology to come to decisions have become quite obvious and quite familiar to us. And at the same time, it's so new that we need some clear thinking and very new tools to understand what this actually means. And this is why we have teamed up with Decent tonight to, this is a very interesting project, I'd say, that's trying to do just that, understand how democracy is changed or is changing based on the use of new technologies and help us to understand what this all means. So Decent means decentralized citizens engagement technologies. Yes, okay. These, you'll know that better, huh? Okay. So that's a project that it has run for 2 years now, and it has developed tools together with organizations that actually know what they're doing. So these are organizations that have practiced using technology for quite a while to change the way that the government is working. And we think we can learn quite a lot. So when I learned that this project, Decent, had been running for a year or so, I thought this is a good reason to bring Decent to the Netherlands and help us understand how to go about using technology for these new causes. So I'm very, very happy that the Decent project has come. So please give them a warm applause now. So we have a very dense and interesting program, I think. The program is here. We start with an introduction by Francesca. Francesca is the project lead for Decent. Then we have Natalie Eskenazi sitting here and Jaromil, who will talk about the actual tools that have been made so far. And then we have a panel. I call it the Polder panel because it's about how how Holland or the Netherlands could learn from what has been going on there. We have 5 speakers for that as well. And finally, we have Evgeny Morozov, who will talk about the future of technology and democracy. And anyway, he has a kind of a free brief, so we'll see what he does. The drinks are after. You'll do the drink. We'll all do the drinks. Okay. So first of all, we'll listen and discuss. But what for us is even much more important is that you get inspired by what has been going on. You forge new links between each other, and you come with your own projects. So you try to appropriate those tools as well. And see if they are the right ones, or see if you can change or make them bigger or something. So that, if that will happen somehow, then we are very happy on this side. So my name is Frank Kresin. I'm the research director for Waag Society, developing technology for social innovation. And I will be the moderator, and it mainly means that this should be your evening. So I'm only happy when you think that the topics and the discussions are worthwhile. So please make your voices heard. So now, without further ado, let me introduce Francesca Bria. Here she is. So Francesca is a senior Nesta advisor and the project lead for both Decent and the DSI for Europe project, researching digital social innovation. She's also an advisor for the European Commission on collective awareness platforms, the Internet of Things, and smart city policies.
Get in there. So good evening, everyone. And first of all, thank you very much for the Waag for inviting us and for having us here. And of course, to the Dutch group of Decent for setting up this this evening. So let's say the objective of my presentation is really to tell you the story of the Decent project, where we started, what we've been doing throughout the last 2 years, and what are the achievements of this project. Because I have to say it's been an exciting process. I work at Nesta, which is the UK Innovation Agency, And Decent is a Europe-wide project, maybe one of the largest efforts in Europe that is working on future democratic infrastructures. So building democratic tools, civic infrastructures for participation, engagement in policy, and helping basically organizations, political organizations, grassroots movements, political parties, and civil society organizations to build what we call the next generation democracy tools that are open, that are decentralized, that devolve power to the citizens, and allow also citizens to be in control of the technology they're using, to own their data, and to trust the systems that allow them to participate, interact, and change the political process. So it has been very exciting for us. We started from three main questions, which are pretty broad and ambitious. So it is an ambitious, it is an ambitious project, I have to say, because when you talk about changing democratic institutions, we're talking about changing the 19th century system that has been working for so long, our parliaments, our political parties, our, you know, democratic institutions. And of course, our question is how we can design new democratic institutions that are best suited to next generation democracy, so that are open, experimental, that can get participation of the citizens in a different way from the representative democracy. Basically, you are allowed to vote one time every few years, and your opinion is not really taken into account. So it is very hard for citizens to have their opinion taking, really influencing the political issues. And it's also not easy for citizens to self-organize, so to do something about problems they care about, and to have large-scale civic action in place, and then to basically give solutions, to provide solutions and implement them in the way that is best for them. So we call this collective intelligence in the political system, which moves away from the technocratic expertise of institutions that most of the time or sometime are not transparent, are not accountable, and they're corrupted also. So it's also a way for to kind of turn around sometimes what is perceived as a big brother, right? So the kind of digital panopticon of our age with infrastructures that are very invasive and control too much power about us, and turn it around, so maybe do it a little brother, where citizens are actually empowered and they are the ones that can decide what is best for them. So we've been learning a lot from social movement and popular movements around the world that have been you know, reclaiming more social justice. For instance, you know, starting from the Indignados movement in Spain, the 15M, which was a societal movement really reclaiming democracy. Like, their motto was democracy now. Of course, Occupy Wall Street, you know, the entire wave globally of popular movements that were demanding a change in the political system has been the starting point of the Decent Project. And then we have seen that a lot of people, especially the young generation, youth, really lost hope in the system. So they look at the system and they say, the system is broken. It doesn't give us any trust in the future. We don't trust our politicians. We do not trust the structure of society, so we disengage. So a lot of people really lost hope in politics. They just left the political arena. But we thought that these are the people that are our, you know, that are the decent citizens, are the youth, the young people that have to take power into their own hands, and we can build a democracy that is best suited to engage social movement and youth people that are demanding more transparency and a better system. So we learned, of course, for the rise of new political party. I don't know how much in Holland you have heard about Podemos. Podemos is a movement, is a political party, but more a citizen movement that in Spain has gained traction after the 15M, and now is the third biggest political party in Spain. And it really has an interesting structure. We call it network movement or network party because it combines the element of really the social movement democratic organizing, so democratic assemblies, debate in neighborhoods. They have círculos, which are neighborhood organizations that, that have the membership of the political party. So they really do the kind of work like door-to-door and street organizing with community groups, with neighborhoods. But at the same time, they have a very advanced way to use technology. So they have a big Podemos Plaza, which is a big forum where the membership engage, where they debate, where they take decisions, where they vote for candidates, they propose issues, they get taken into account in the way they shape political manifestos, the party manifesto, the political program. So they're really combining online and offline democracy in a very interesting way, and also components of, let's say, a more direct democracy that you were referring at the beginning of the speech, and representative democracy. So these are the kind of hybrids that we think are very interesting. And probably this is the new type of political party in the 21st century. So it has been for us very important to work with the movement in Spain that gained power in the latest municipal elections. I don't know how much also you know this story in Holland, but this is Barcelona en Común and Ahora Madrid, which are also part of Podemos, but they represent a wider citizen-led movement that decided to run for elections in the city, latest administrative elections. And then they won the main cities in Spain. So Barcelona, Madrid, and other seven cities are now run by governments that are composed by the citizen coalitions. So with the Decent project, we've been working with them to create some of the tools and infrastructure that they use now, for instance, for the creating the committees that created the program. The ethical code of the organization was all voted online through secure voting. And also, I mean, now that they are in Barcelona and Madrid, the mayor of Barcelona, I don't know if you know, but she comes from the housing movement, so she's a radical activist. She used to protect families that were evicted from the housing because the speculation of the financial system on housing, and now she's the mayor of Barcelona, and she has this very radical program. She calls Barcelona the city of change, the democratic city, and they're implementing a lot of the decent democratic agenda there. So we've been working also with the Five Star Movement, which is a movement in Italy that also really kind of was shaking the Italian political system, and they have the direct democracy at the core of their DNA, I would say. So everything, all the membership are voted online, they debate a lot of the things online, the candidates are voted through online procedures. I mean, of course, this has some very good sides because it's more transparent and people feel engaged. Of course, sometimes it can feel it's less representative or you struggle to engage as much people as you want. But they are the second most important political party now in Italy, and they also replicating the work that they do in the parliament with their parliamentarians. They have a platform where all the laws and everything they vote in the parliament, you can look at them and you can contribute, the membership can contribute ideas and everything. And I think it's a very sophisticated operating system for the next generation parliaments, and the Five Star Movement is very involved in that. Then another of our partners, the citizen initiatives in Finland, we've been learning a lot about, you know, bottom-up crowdsourcing of the legislation. So in Finland, you can gather 50,000 signatures and citizens can together collaborate on a bill that can be voted in parliament. And they had a lot of victories, like laws that were written by citizens, like the same marriage law and animal rights laws, legislation or environmental legislation, that now are part of their laws in Finland. And also they managed to change the constitution so that citizen initiatives are possible and they're easy to happen. And now they moved a lot of these procedures online. So for the citizens also it's easy to have their signature verified online with a digital signature. They can use tools to collaborate on laws. So it makes the process much more simple, because if you have to gather all these signatures, you have to go in the street and collect them, and sometimes it's hard work. So it makes just the process a bit more easy. Then we've seen, of course, a constitutional referendum taking place. I mean, we had the Scottish referendum, the campaign for civil marriage equality. In Italy, there was a big civic referendum for against privatization of water and for the common goods. That was very, very important. So we see this kind of bottom-up movements coming more and more forward. Another interesting example of more kind of democratic participation in the economic space is the participatory budgeting. So one of the partners of Decent in Iceland, the Your Priorities, they're building the participatory budgeting platform that is now used in Reykjavik to allocate part of the budget, of the municipal budget, to projects that are chosen by the citizens. They allocated 2 million euros. I mean, Reykjavik is pretty small, and now this experiment has been replicated in other cities through the Decent partner and through the Decent project. And now the city of Madrid just announced the allocation of 16 million euros for participatory budgeting, which is allocated to projects that are chosen and voted and prioritized by citizens themselves. So this is what Decent has been about. We built on this kind of experiments in Europe. We've been testing, we've been working bottom up with the communities, and then we brought a kind of idea of a technology, of an infrastructure that allow these democratic experiments that is open, federated, privacy aware, and tools that allow for democratic participation. So why we choose to do that? Because we thought that a lot of the people that are using technologies, many citizen groups, for instance, they were using tools like Facebook or Twitter or whatever, Google tools, to do the same things. So what is wrong with that? I mean, nothing in principle. The only problem is that these tools are not designed for democratic participation, for meaningful democratic participation. They're tools where you don't know really who owns your data, you cannot control the technology. The technology is built to basically maximize specific behavior, usually it's driven by advertising, we know. So it maximizes some kind of efficiency behavior. For market-driven purposes, it's okay, but for democratic accountability, participation, and trust, these weren't the tools that we thought, you know, people didn't trust to build this kind of experiments. So we thought we need a new infrastructure, and this infrastructure should allow citizens to be in control. So starting from controlling your data to privacy awareness and be aware of what's happening with the technology you use, of course, open source. And we have been working with the W3C to standardize some of these issues through open standards. So a lot of the Decent people participated in working groups that were there to standardize the social web standards so that people can have data portability and lots of rights associated to the use of the technology. So we hope that with our effort, not only we provide a positive vision of collective intelligence and democracy in the 21st century, but also that this can spread. And so more experiments can be run that are based on the same kind of principle. So our partners, yeah, we have all across Europe, and so we can be proud that now our tools are actually being used across Europe at scale. And I just want to mention that the Decentralizing project is part of a big effort in the European Commission that has been allocating over 60 million euros for this kind of experiment. It's called the Collective Awareness Platform for Sustainability and Social Innovation, where also the Commission, that is perceived as a pretty technocratic top-down organization, if they have to do anything, it's very technology push, and usually the people that get resources are the big companies like telcos or so on. But they realized that there was more to that, that it wasn't just a technological problem, that you have to empower the communities that can use this technology for the social good. And so there is now this program running, and I mean, we are contributing with the Decent project to make this wider and bigger, because we believe that Europe has a stake in this. So Jaramil and Natalie will talk much more about the Decent tools later. So they will show you the platform, what the tools do, allow people to propose ideas, debate options, draft solutions and option together collectively, vote and make decision offline. So there is a collective deliberation process, and then implement the policy And we're also now working, experimenting with blockchain technology to make it transparent and accountable. And Jeremy will talk about that, how the blockchain technology fits in the decent vision. You're probably a blockchain developer here in the first row. Anyways, we'll talk about the details later. And so we present really a federated ecosystem of tools, which is really agnostic about, we don't say you have to use this platform or this other platform. They're federated because they all use open standards and free software. And so we hope that this ecosystem can grow with the varieties and heterogeneous tools that can communicate and based on the same kind of principles. Just I want to mention really some of the success of the Decent project. So now we have these pilots running in Barcelona with the new city government that is using this Decidim Barcelona. It's a tool which has been developed together with the Decent project, and this is the main participation platform of the city of Barcelona. And they already use it to do the planning, the city planning, and allocate basically resources for the next 5 years. And they've used the tool to aggregate opinion from the citizens, to debate priorities, and also to make citizens aware of what the government can do, what the city is doing. Then we have Reykjavik, the participatory budgeted platform that now has been also adopted in Madrid. So there is already collaboration across cities. And then in Helsinki, they're running a bunch of experiments. Actually, we have some people from Helsinki here as well. One of the decent experiments has been tracking municipal policy decision. They have an open API for the decisions that are taking at city council. And then citizens can be notified and start participatory processes based on this data. So this is very important, because when you open up the data, in order for the data to be actionable, basically for citizens not only to be overloaded by information, but to understand what is relevant for them, and then to participate, to open up a process where they can understand what this data means and then activate a bottom-up process. That was what was interesting for us. And then in Madrid, there is this now the participation platform of the city of Madrid, which is the Cide Madrid, and there are already, I actually have some slides because I think it's pretty amazing. They set up this participation platform, and after like only a month, they had 400 debates, more than 6,000 proposals, over 10,000 citizens that started debating on the platform. And this is really just the beginning. So we're really seeing this is not just a technological advancement, this is changing the politics at city level. Because when you know you open up the way you take decision, you give the citizen the power to actually propose and implement and be part of the policy making process, then you see that you're changing the relation to the citizen. And so it's we think that this is kind of changing very much the trust as well. And okay, you can look, I mean, we have a lot of like detailed analysis on our website. We are also producing research, so we are analyzing data. We publish everything in Creative Commons and in open source. So I think this is also a project that is offering a lot of learning, like a lot of insights. You can see what we're doing and you can learn from it. And this is the participatory budgeting platform just launched last week that I was talking about before. And yeah, and this is just, you know, the kind of dashboards that we're building on top of these tools. So you can see that the analytics, you can also have the ability to learn a lot of things about how people organize, how people take decisions, what is needed at city level, and all of that. So yeah, the last thing I want to mention really is that the Decent project is also about multidisciplinary research. So we do not only code and make software that works. We also learn in collaboration between social scientists, economists, people that are expert on participation and democracy and work with the community. So if you go to our website, we have produced research in a variety of fields like citizen participation, collective intelligence framework, the commons, like how to manage technological infrastructure as a common and what is the role of digital commons in contemporary society, and also reflecting around data privacy and the security by design and all these kind of important things when you manage technological infrastructure and future distributed architectures. So the Decent project is a building block towards a much bigger aim of distributing power also in the way we use technology. And so finally, why use decent, or why be interested also in the technology part, in the architecture, is because we think that it's very important that people own their data. So privacy by design and giving control of the data back to the citizen using open source and open standards enable us to build knowledge commons and to have replicable experiments across Europe and beyond Europe. And then well, we're working with distributed open authentication and identity management so that we can build an ecosystem. And then what blockchain trust, because we also think that it's important that citizens can work in an auditable, transparent manner. So we're working with technologies that make transparency better for citizens. I mean, and this is also, I just want to end by saying, reverting again the kind of Big Brother or the digital panopticon, right? Because all the time, the transparency is mainly transparency about us. So we're giving out a lot of our data, we get tracked and monitored all the time, and basically it's we are transparent and less so power. So we want to revert this situation and make actually power more transparent and more accountable, and basically get rid of the corruption and empower the citizens. So the transparency should be the other way around. I mean, this is just some reflections, really, when I present Decent, about some of the things that we learn in this project. And, you know, one thing, because many people ask us, how can we do this? I mean, how can we actually do digital democracy, and what should we do? And, like, what we always say is, you have to start with bottom-up engaged citizens and the movement. It's not happening like that. You can't start with the technology. You need hybrid physical and digital space, always in combination, otherwise, and you need to align the technology with organizational change, and then integrate collective intelligence in the decision-making processes for real, so collaborative policymaking and collective deliberation, and then how do we make sustainable? So we have to create sustainable structures and reward citizen participation towards building digital commons. So yeah, so this is the Decent story, and I think my colleagues afterwards, they will tell much more in detail what are the different tools we're using, if you're interested in anything. I think at this moment, we do have a lot of interest coming from like new groups at a variety of level, citizen movements, but also political party and also governments that are starting more and more to think about these issues and to work in this way. So we really hope that this is, as I was saying before, a building block towards a more sustained change, and in particular the combination between technology and democratic politics that we feel is really important. Thank you very much.
Wow, you've tried to put 2 years of work into 20 minutes of presentation, huh? You did a lot, I'd say.
Yeah.
Just wait a second, because before you leave, there's time for two or three questions. And the first one is mine. It's who is the main audience for all the work that you've done?
The main audience?
Yes.
Well, I think the main audience is, we have thousands of people that are involved in the Decent platform. So our main audience has been, first of all, I mean, more than audience are like engaged citizens, right? So we have been, used a little bit of a lean methodology to build software, in a sense that we really went on the ground from day one. So we worked with the political organizations and groups that were carrying out their political work. And we went there and understand what their needs are, what they're doing, what are the problems, in particular in at the level of the organization, and what was technology enabling them to do. And then we learned what it was needed and what we had to build. And together with ThoughtWorks, we've done a lot of these kind of workshops. So I think our main audience were the citizen groups, the large citizens organization. Yeah. And I mean, now, because also the way the Decent project has evolved, they're also in governments, in city levels, and political parties. So I think it's really the kind of political space. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Are there any questions from the audience? Maybe one or two?
So I wonder how it relates to liquid democracy and the initiatives of the German Fire Party.
Yeah. So yeah, we did quite a bit of work with them also at the very beginning of the project. And one of the partner, which is the IMI in Iceland, they are the founders of the Icelandic Pirate Party, and they are part of Decent. And so we, I think we learned a lot from them and also from their failures. So I think what it was clear in the case of the Pirate Party, it was that they had a little too technocratic approach to the problem. So they were really into procedures. So for them, like, they already had in mind how the technology had to work. And they really prioritized procedures which were technologically written over what was really needed to make better decisions. And I think they got stuck in that kind of problems. And for them, it was now, you know, they almost became slave of the software that they were using. And many people were telling us, this is actually not really working for the purpose you're trying to solve, for the problem you're trying to solve. So we tried to stay a bit away of that and try to build more simple tools that allow for larger participation. Because, you know, it's clear from our cases in Barcelona, if you look, actually, we have some age statistics are amazing. You believe these are all kind of digital natives, kids, hipsters? No. I mean, a lot of the people in Barcelona or Madrid using these tools, they're over 60. I mean, they're people that are just participating in the political life. So you have to make these tools pretty simple and intuitive and easy to use.
There's probably somebody from the Pirate Party.
We learned a lot.
Happy for it was with Emilia some years ago. I was still here. I once found Pirate Party International, which is the international framework for pirate parties around the world. But I really have to point out, be quick about it, what really happened with the German Pirate Party with their experiment is actually really disgusting and something people should never forget. You're just told a political correct story, but what really happened is that the leadership of the party abused liquid feedback in order to commit policy laundering, which is also why the founders and creators of liquid feedback eventually left the German Pirate Party for good reasons, and I love them for it. But this is reality, and these platforms, I love them, but please know that they can easily be abused. Thank you.
Last question now to Francesca.
Are you really focused on cities, but is it also working on national level, all those tools you're...
So I think we didn't decide to focus on cities. So I think that, like, for us, it's also a reflection. We were thinking about it, why cities? So I think it emerged that the city, and then I know that you have a lot of things to say about governments. I mean, I have to say, like, why the city? It became clear that the city is a connector, and they have proximity to the citizens, and they can play a very important role when it comes to democratic engagement and participation. So it was more natural for us to start working at city scale, and I think the city was a perfect scale to really test our experiments and you know, make a change in the way that things are organized. But first of all, there is a lot of interest political parties-wise, so political parties operate at a national scale. I think parliaments, until now, we've seen it's very hard to change from inside the way that parliaments operate. For instance, the regulation or legislative process are very different, and so it takes some time to understand how you can really be effective there. But I mean, in the UK Digital Democracy, for instance, committee came to our events all the time, and they interacted, they took a lot of insights, and they are actually very interested. So I think there is a scope to look at higher level and to experiment at different levels.
Thank you. Yeah, Jaco wants to say, because he's from Finland, maybe you can introduce yourself.
Yes, so I'm Jaco Koronen from Open Knowledge in Finland and in Helsinki, and I've been working for Decent Project. And actually, just from Friday to Monday, we've had an event with the Finnish Parliament, with the Decent tools, to actually hack these tools in. And the Parliament has just recently purchased new software to kind of like handle all their decisions. And what the hackathon has been about is to give guidelines from the citizens to the Parliament, so that when they make the next development steps with the decision making, like how they handle their decision making data, that in the following months, or maybe during this year anyway, we could have decent tools working on top of the parliament data in Finland. So this is just a very recent decent dissemination activity we've had. So I hope it becomes a reference for other European parliaments to do the same.
Thank you very much.
With that, we have about 8 more speakers, so give her a big hand as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now coming up, we have 2 speakers that actually made the tools or have been working with the tools very much. It's Natalie Eskenazi. She's from ThoughtWorks, which is a major company with 3,000 employees, but you're from the UK side of it, and you'll talk about the tools. And then you'll be followed by Dennis Royo, who is more widely known as Jaromil, who is a world-class open source developer, has been doing so for quite a long time, and he'll talk about the tools as well. So please give them a hand too.
No. I already did. That's not old. It's fine. Yeah, there I am.
No, you have to click.
Just click it.
Okay.
Yeah. And that one. Marvelous. Okay. Sorry, clicker. This one. Cool. Hello, I'm Natalie. So I'm a software developer at ThoughtWorks. We're a global company who we specialize in agile and lean software development. I'm not going to go into too much detail, just a little introduction. So we have been the one of the partners on the Decent project. We have built 3 tools that I will go into detail about. But to begin with, I'm just, you've heard a little bit about this from Francesca, so I'm just going to talk a little about why we made, I guess, the ideas around that we had to keep in mind while building these tools. So all these tools are open source, which is important for several reasons, for transparency in the code, so people can have a look through it, so that people can, we really had an idea of creating a community around these tools, hoping that developers would want to contribute and raise issues, as well as, of course, the fact that as for open source, they can be self-hosted, which very much moves towards our centralized goal as well. Another important thing is that these tools have been built in a modular way. So they should be very interoperable. So they should work well together. They should also work by themselves. And also importantly, we didn't just want these tools to work with other Decent tools. We wanted them to be able to work with external tools, which we're using. And the way we've done this is by using web standards, which I'll go into more detail about them later, with regards to the specific tools. But what it means is that if other tools are using the same standards, then it's easier to integrate them together. Also, really important is that this is a European project and that these tools are all easily translated, which we've built in that functionality. So if anyone wanted to use these tools and like, it's not my language, you can just take the file, one of the language files, and just create your own, you know, translate appropriately, and there you go. And we've sort of spoken about how they're federated already. And with regards to them being privacy aware and secure, I'll talk about that more specifically when I'm talking about the tools. So just for the developers in the room, if anyone's interested, we built them all in Clojure and Clojure script. A couple of them use Mongo, one of them use Postgres. We also built more using, we recently put them all in Docker, so we wanted to make sure that these were easily deployable even by people who weren't necessarily very technically savvy. So to the non-developers in the room, I will move on. okay, so Objective 8. Objective 8 is a policy drafting tool that allows organizations to work with their members to produce transparent and crowdsourced policy and manifestos. So what that means is basically, so supposing I am a political party or an organization and I want to create new policy and manifestos and I want to know what the members of my organization actually care about. I want to make sure that I'm creating the right policy for them, as well as obviously giving them an opportunity to easily contribute and have their opinions heard. So if I can give an example, supposing I work for an organization and I want to challenge our policy, our current policy on maternity and paternity leave, for example. I could then raise an objective, and my objective would be that I think we need a more robust idea about how we handle it when people have kids in the company. And then other members of the organization can go and they can comment, they can ask questions. These can be upvoted as well or downvoted. And then I can see, before I've even written a draft, what people care about. And then I can write my first draft, and then people can comment on it, they can annotate, and I can continuously collect information from people until a point when, I guess, you know, you sort of decide when it's done. But then I can create new drafts, and the members of the organization can even see the difference between the drafts, so they can see how I've incorporated that information. So that's just one possible use. It's very sort of, I can think of a lot of different ways in which you could use this tool, especially when it comes to political parties and generating manifestos, but that's just one example for you. So I think if I move on to the next one, which is Stonecutter. So Stonecutter is a secure single sign-on tool that provides federated and privacy-aware user management for organizations. So for people who don't necessarily know what I mean by a single sign-on tool, if you've ever logged into an application using Facebook or Google or Twitter, that wasn't those sites, that's a single sign-on. You're using another login to sign into another website, another application. So the issue around this is that what you're doing is that whenever you do that is you are not only giving, like letting Facebook or Google or Twitter, you're letting these organizations know which sites you're using. You're giving them that information, which you might not care about, but you also might. So you're letting them know what sites you're using. At the same time, Facebook isn't your primary use for it isn't necessarily to sign into something. Your primary use is to, I don't know, share photos, chat with your friends, you know, keep in contact with people. So actually, when you use that to sign into another application, that application can ask for a lot of information, and it tells you what information it's going to share, but you don't have much say over it. You can't choose which information you want to use. If you wanted to stop that application using that information, you'd have to actually change it in Facebook, which you might not want to do. So it's got this sort of double purpose, and your requirements for each don't necessarily match. So what you have with something like Stonecutter is you have, so if I choose to use Stonecutter to sign into various applications, Stonecutter isn't used for anything else. That is what it's used for. So I can make a decision about what information I put in there. And this is why it's privacy aware, because we're saying that if I'm comfortable with these applications that are hooked up to my Stonecutter to see my profile picture, then fine, then I'll put my profile picture in. But there's absolutely no reason why I have to. There's nothing making me do that. That's very much my choice. And I know that only the information that I put in my profile card on Stonecutter will be shared. So that's a big part of why it's good to have a single sign-on which is sort of specifically for that purpose. But also a really important thing is about the fact that the data that I am storing in Stonecutter isn't necessarily going to be owned by some external corporation that I have no connection to. So if it's within my workplace, for example, then the only people who have access to that database are my workplace. They're the people who are hosting it. So in terms of data sharing, it's much more decentralized. So with regards to, I mentioned open standards earlier. So we're using OpenID Connect, which is a web standard authentication protocol. Anything else that uses OpenID Connect, you could very easily integrate those two tools together, those two applications. Another sort of quite useful thing is about organizations sharing user bases. So if you can imagine that I'm an organization and I have Stonecutter to sign into various applications, and supposing there's another there's another tool that's been created that would be very useful, possibly, to people within my organization, I can very easily plug that tool into Stonecutter, and then all of my users now have access to that other tool if they so choose. Mooncake. Mooncake is a tool to securely notify your members of events and activity on your Decent ecosystem. So Mooncake is, it's an activity feed. So this uses Activity Streams 2.0, which is another open standard. We've been working with the World Wide Web Consortium to define this standard. It's basically a format for your data. So any tools that are publishing activity streams, Mooncake could accept those activity streams and then give you relevant updates. So for example, if my Decent ecosystem had had Objective 8, had a policy drafting tool, had a free coin, which you will hear about from Yarmil later, and I don't know, so someone created a new objective in Objective 8, or they asked a question, then that would appear on my Mooncake feed. And I could also customize my feed to decide which information I care about, which information I don't. And yes, so those are all my tools. And I think Yarmil's going to take over now and talk about Freecoin, and then we'll take questions at the end from everyone.
Yes, I'll take it from here, as it is a collaboration. It has been a fantastic experience for me to work with Natalie and her team at ThoughtWorks. I represent a smaller, way smaller organization with a shorter history, yet quite long. We started in 94 with the dream of doing free media online, developing software for free radio, for doing streaming, live streaming online. And we proceed now maintaining some old museum of the computer, of historical computers functioning. We are a community of hackers. So basically, we work on these principles that you say there. That you see there, I didn't even wrote down the free software and open source because it goes implicitly pretty much. And actually, we found that into the what was shaping as the decent tools was pretty much attuned with the philosophy of Unix tools. One of the principles that we wanted to follow since the beginning is modularity. In Decent, we are not building one tool to rule them all. We are trying to build many little tools that you can combine as puzzles. And that's important, especially if you consider the importance of a single sign-on. We have one of the few open source softwares that support OpenID Connect, so that you can basically, the Waag society could have it running, and then you could have login with Waag into the various websites where you see constantly, you know, logging with Facebook and with Twitter. So that is about identity management, really much. A city could have this. Anyway, our role was researching especially into the most used media around the world, money. That is a pretty old school one, so actually the media archaeology approach is useful to that. And we started really researching into the in complementary currencies, not from a technical perspective immediately, but really starting from the theme of currency and how you can use that to actually follow how decisions are operated, but also how power is accumulated, because you understand that politics is conditioned also by information. Informed consensus is actually made by the media, and nowadays media is made with money, with expertise, with infrastructure. We draw from Bitcoin success. So of course, beyond the hype, there must be something around there that is not just kittens and myths. So we try to find out what are the technologies behind. We identified into the blockchain a core component that is also nowadays pretty much hyped. We try to keep the feet on ground and individuate what are the functionalities really to blockchain. So we identify the three main functions: authentication, distribution, and proof of work, what is called the proof of work. So we started asking ourselves, actually, is there a social dimension for this proof of work? If in a system that is completely neutral like Bitcoin, we can establish the truth as in running an algorithm and actually consuming electricity and actually burning that electricity into a digital asset. Can we transform that work into a social consensus process? Could we actually imagine a clearinghouse, an amount of money that is created with the consensus of a community, which we already do on a very large scale, but could we have that on a small scale? Could we have that traceable? Could we have that verifiable by external organizations, so that your small organization has created an asset, distributes it, organizes the work around that asset, and other organizations can trust actually the history, the genealogy of that usage that we can present to them. So, of course, all this discussion is about trust. And trust is actually at the base of the financial crisis we are witnessing. We are witnessing is a credit crisis. And beyond credit, there is trust. So how can we use these sort of tools for credit risk mitigation? How can we actually help trust to be represented? Because obviously, in these movements that Francesca talked about, there is an abundance of trust that is not organized. Because no one trusts anymore the banks, perhaps here in the Netherlands more, in Spain, I can assure you, the majority doesn't trust banks anymore. But when people are camping out in the street for days without stabbing each other in the back until police comes and beat them up, then obviously there is an abundance of trust that is there, that is claimed from the grassroots, from the bottom up. And what about these reliabilities, this blockchain, this deus ex machina that should establish what is truth and what is not, that should be solving one of the biggest questions that philosophers pose themselves from since the beginning. So actually, we wanted to look also in technologies that have a long-term maintainability, that really hold the promise, that are reliable. And speaking of a technology that has been so hyped and exists since 5 years, you understand this is very difficult. So one of the conclusions, actually, is that we must wait before assessing what is really there and what is not. Nowadays, we have a lot of marketing around that, but we have also a lot of technologies that existed before and actually could do what blockchains are doing now and even better. So deconstructing the functions that blockchains have is a fundamental approach. So what we came up with is a tool that we individuate was missing from this ecosystem. We didn't start our own blockchain because there are many there out there. We studied the APIs of most existing blockchains. We started to build a minimum viable API, let's say, that a set of instructions that most blockchains out there have. And we built a social wallet, which is basically a wallet in which the entry can be regulated. It's integrated into Stonecutter, so it's a single sign-on that grants a contextual integrity. So people from outside don't know what is happening inside necessarily, but inside everything is transparent. You have actually a vision of all the transactions that other people do. You have a vision of also other people's wallets and how much they have, because actually it is built for communities that have an affinity, that have no problem in showing each other what is really happening. And I'm sure with the polder model, you can actually relate to this. So basically, I just look at you and think, well, but yeah, we came up with a software that was also informed by the practices of ThoughtWorks. We adopted Clojure as a language, which I think is ideal and hints about the future of blockchains, because it's a tool, it's a language that per se is functional, is non-imperative, is stateless, so it really works well as a language for blockchains. But in this case, we use it for a software, and we covered it completely with test cases. So we use a very slow think approach. Let's say this is, I dare to say, the slow food of software. We didn't jump on something to build it immediately. We tried to cover it completely with test units. So every single action that you can do in this software, every time we change the code, is re-verified through all the user journeys if it validates. So because when you maintain a software for many years, you understand that people could change a line of code and the software could break and not do anymore what you do. And you want to check that on every single line of code that is being changed. So actually, if we talk about reliability, we have to start from the methodology of how we write and maintain code even before the actual tech that is going to save the world and all the kittens around. So basically, this is the Freecoin in brief, the elevator pitch. And that's more or less our focus, our promise, whether or not is maintained, we will see in the future, because this actually is a software that spans beyond Decent. At Dyne.org, we are extremely interested in maintaining it and applying it in use cases around. We understand it's very useful. We start adopting it already for our own organization, because eating your own dog food is the best way to improve it, actually. So it is still a web application. We don't dare to actually offer people another software to install on their mobile and eventually have some risks and responsibility with that. We use it, we like to think of it as integratable into systems, be it into an iframe or actually with the API. And it's supporting one important feature. I don't go too much in the technical detail, which is the sort of multi-signature, what is called in the blockchain world, authentication, so that we have a splitting of the keys, so that actually the key to the access of the wallet is not on the server, is not on the side of the user, but with a Shamir secret sharing algorithm, we actually split the key so that the user and the server, and eventually another server, an auditor, have to have all these keys reconstructed to access the actual wallet. So this is how we solved also cases in which if you lose the key to your blockchain account, then the organization with an auditor verifying your identity could recuperate it, or also other cases in which you can imagine the organization disappears, but the person can still go to the auditor and recuperate the access to the blockchain. Because what is very important to understand is that one of the advantages that blockchain technology we can assess offers us is that beyond the existence and the maintenance of a database, of a single database by an organization, we can be sure that if the organization disappears, if the blockchain still runs across a peer-to-peer network, then we can still access it. So the things that the values, the assets that we put there, they can be still there. So we don't depend from a single organization. There could be a network of organizations and this sort of a neutral ground or more neutral ground that is a blockchain. So that's it for the tech, I guess. Yeah.
Thank you very much. My first question will be, how mature is the technology for the cases that you presented, so the tools, and what do you need to be able to run them? So what knowledge do you need to be able to assess or start or do anything?
I guess how mature is the technologies? Well, I mean, I would very much consider them to still be an alpha, because at the moment, whilst we have people about to be using these tools, we haven't had any real users, and I think until you do, there are a lot of things that will come out of that that you'll want to, you know, you might want to change, or like a user journey that you might want to change. So that's where I consider they are at the moment. But sorry, what was your second question? Yes, sir. Well, I mean, yeah, so at the moment we have been working to try and make it more easily deployable, and it certainly is more easily deployable than it was before. I would say that you still need a certain amount of technical knowledge, for sure. We would very much like to get to the point where you would need very minimal technical expertise to be able to deploy these tools. But yeah, I guess that's a work in progress, really. So that is actually what we're currently working on doing.
In case of Freecoin, of course, all this part of the research in Decent is way more experimental than the rest. So let's say it's not yet, even at the moment, we have still some months to really go and crunch the code, because most of the research so far was also on the social cases, on the use cases on the ground. So we didn't want to go and write code immediately. So I would say Freecoin is probably the less mature component, but the methodology we are following, I believe, is very mature. The methodology of having a literate programming approach and of having test units built on each single user journey that we do. So we move on a ground that we secure at every step. And of course, also the choice of a language as closure, which is a little bit less orthodox, but I believe it's a very mature choice, and that was also suggested by the first team at ThoughtWorks that lay down the ground, because it allows less space for error for programmers that tackle it. It can really be welcoming also contributions without a risk for the whole infrastructure.
Yeah, it leads to really nice design of the tools. Great. I will sort of just take the opportunity, actually, while we're talking about this, to say that, just to reiterate that these are open source tools. So for any developers in the room who would like to do a bit of closure, we welcome it. So have a play.
Bitcoin is presented on the 18th of March at the Dutch Closure Days. It's been also selected by the community of programmers, of closure programmers. There are many, actually, here in Randstad, especially. And we will present it on the 18th of March. You can look up Dutch Closure Days.
Thank you. One or two questions from the audience. Can you describe the use case for free code?
Sure. Well, I will describe the one I'm most familiar with. Imagine that we have really eating we are eating our own dog food. We have a job, a work that we divide in work packages. We can imagine to have wallets for each work package, and these wallets that can be designed with hours and actual currency, and people could work for each work package, send their hour, and hours would zero each other, and receive money from the work package. So this what means is that we have a more horizontal interaction within the organization. We don't need to ask the project manager constantly to allocate a budget for another person in the organization we want to work with, because actually having a wallet that I check out perhaps every month, I could just realize that the work package has more hours available, ask my colleague to work on the basis of that work package, or even use my own wallet to pay the colleague, because I understand I took more from the work package and I needed still someone else's expertise to fill in some tasks. So it creates a more organic way to distribute work, and at the end of the month I can have automatically a timesheet and also a balance of what I did or not. This is just one simple thing that can relate well to small organizations. Of course there are a lot of more things, and we call Freecoin a toolkit because it's not a finished product. We work with currency designers in our organization that are not as technical, but they are very specialized in understanding what a community or what an organization does. So you go on the field, you study the situation, and you can have very different system. It was very fascinating to work in a workshop with Amato and Fantacci, two of the major representatives in Italy at least, but also in Europe, of Keynesian approaches to organizing budgets. And it's very fascinating how this sort of forgotten knowledge into economy could be applied also in smaller communities in creating currency systems, in creating clearing houses. And with our colleagues at the Sorbonne, ultimately, our dream for Freecoin is really to have it as an instrument to create bottom-up clearing houses.
Is there one more question? Two more questions. Can you tell us who you are?
My name is Ronald. Bitcoin enthusiast, but I would like to know what your idea about your completely distributed Bitcoin architecture is about this Docker type federated, not so much distributed, man in the middle attack. I mean, Freecoin seems very much distributed, whereas the rest isn't.
Actually, Freecoin is a web app, so it's not as much distributed. In my experience, it's an ideal world of enthusiasts and crypto punks and cypherpunks. In an ideal world, it's fine to have a software installed on each other machine, and it's very fascinating when you have a community like Bitcoin that it manages to do that, manages to maintain such a code. But in many realities in which we intervene, we notice that the community is way more heterogeneous. People don't have these skills. And what the community needs to do is needs to rely on a group of technical expertise that can grant that this application runs on one machine that needs to be secure, and people rely on this sort of security and access just a web page. rather than installing a software. This is way simpler for the deployment of a community. It, of course, introduces a vulnerability, an attack surface. And this attack surface we try to mitigate with the use of secret service, Shamir secret service, secret sharing. Did I say secret service? Oh my God. Did I say secret service?
I think we'll have a break. Well, of course we'll have a bottle, and you can find each other there. I think we have. It's a quick question.
It's quite a fundamental question. It's about, isn't this a very technocratic solution? While it's a democratic problem we have, and I'm not quite sure if these technocratic tools are really solving the democratic challenges we are having in Europe at the moment. So how does that? I think you're replacing a democratic system with a technocratic system.
A very fundamental question indeed.
So I guess it's not about solving the problem. It's not about finding some sort of magic way that we're just going to make everything better. I think that what I hope that we can achieve with the tools that we've built, and I mean, in a big way, it's kind of just a lot of it is starting the conversation. It's about thinking about what better ways could we find to be more open, to allow people better access to people higher up in, whether it's organizations or parties. It's about giving parties an option, giving them the choice to use these tools and say, look, here's a way that you can really take into consideration what the members of your party care about, really give them an opportunity to have a voice at a higher level without, because so often you find such hierarchical systems and people feel like they don't really know how they're meant to really affect change when they feel they've got to go through all of these different people to get to the people who are actually making those decisions. And I think that something like Objective 8 it's a way to do that if they choose to use it. I mean, yeah, we can't make them, but I think that we're giving them the option. And one of the things I would really love is, I mean, I hope that Objective 8 will continue to grow. Again, it's open source. Who knows what people will do with it. But I think that it's also about, starting a conversation, having people talk about these different things, and trying to figure out if this is the right way, let's try it. Let's even if it fails, one of the big things in software is that we talk a lot about failing fast and failing early, about this idea that you shouldn't be scared of failure, because actually it's so important, because then you find out why something didn't work and what you can do better next time. And I think I'd really like to see what happens at this, and then we can maybe learn from that.
Yeah, I just want to say a sentence on this. So we really didn't start from the technology. I think I hope it was clear from my presentation. So we started from the movements and the political organizations that are changing things. So I do consider, the building of citizen-led organizations that now are empowering cities, and the building of new political parties that are posing the question of democratic deficits or a better and more just economic system. It is a matter of changing things. Now, do you need technology or not? We do believe that you do. And I think also this underestimating that, it's about technopolitics. I mean, in this sense, we have even written about technopolitical solutions and approaches, because we do think it's important to link the two things. So either you have the super technocratic approach of our institution, or you have Silicon Valley stepping in and tell our governments and our cities and our political parties what they have to use. I mean, if you go to the European Parliament, right? I mean, I work in Brussels a lot. And you go in one of these debates about democracy, you always find in the room the representative of Facebook or of Microsoft. At the end of the meeting, the European Commission or the Parliament, they go like, okay, who is building the app? And you have the Microsoft guy or the Facebook guy that they say, oh, now you log in Facebook, and then you have the questionnaire, and please reply to the European Parliament, blah, blah, blah. So this is what we want to change. So if you want a democratic process, you have to follow also with the technology you use and who are the players there in the room that get to say things, right? And this cannot be left to a few companies.
Thank you. Well, this is the moment. Thank you very much for your presentation and your answering the questions. Thank you.
Sorry, yeah. Just one quick thing I wanted to say. Yeah? Actually, if anyone wanted to have a play with the tools, we do actually have live demos at tools.decentproject.eu.
Okay, so write it down. Thank you very much. We have the panel coming up, so maybe all the panelists can sit here. And the panel is consisted of people who have a really very interesting look on the changing the democracy in the Netherlands, I'd say. And we've asked them simple things. We've asked them to respond to the question, first of all, who are you and what is your place in this discussion, in a sense, and how, if and how, the decent tools could be of help in the Dutch case, in your view. So that's the question. And I would like to start with you, Ahmed Arad, because you're first alphabetically.
It is yours, but well, in this respect, I'm here mainly because from the foundation I work for, Stichting Open Source and Overheid, we try to create more sustainable business models for huge companies to actually make a turnaround to more open source models. That's the first case, especially from the economic point of view. The second thing is that I'm very involved with local initiatives in terms of discourse within the public, and from there to develop solutions that we can actually provide to politicians on a non-political basis. So not politically colored, but more from a pragmatic point of view.
Yeah, and could you maybe say a little bit, you've heard these presentations, where do you think that these tools or this approach could be helpful in your context?
There are no tools generally available that actually empower citizens or people in general to participate in a political process, in any political process. And especially now when we see also here in the Netherlands huge debates surrounding, for example, asylum seekers and refugees, you see that the influence of local municipalities is limited to maybe 1 or 2 days that you can actually make your voice heard. And it's usually against or without any result because a decision has already been taken. And I think these tools, and on a very local level, can really help also create communities and connect people so that you know who lives in your street and your neighborhood, etc.
Okay. Thank you. Maybe Marlene, would you like to?
I think Decent makes a very important contribution to the discussion about technology, that technology is not neutral. And it shows that if you have that in each technology, there is a morality and there is an intention. So I think beyond that, these tools are very important. All of them that you came up with, and I hope they all have a future life, and we are going to support them. They're part of a family, of course, of a sort of federative, great family of this kind of tools. But they all have the same DNA, and you make them very explicit. I think that's very important because that can help us to reshape the technology discussion. And in a sense, if you want to have a democratic society, you have to have these kind of principles inside of your technology. So this should be in every technology that governments are actually creating. You should have this as your guiding principle. So in that sense, we've been involved in trying to find out who was working on the follow-up for the DigiD, which is the identity, the digital identity structure that we use in the Netherlands. And so after a year, Tom and I found out who these people were. 60 people somewhere in the government working on this future of the our digital identity. And when we started to talk with them, they were also here to present their projects of their ideas. They said they talked with Amazon.com, with the tax office, and with the card holders, and they didn't speak to any citizen at all in the whole process. So we started some workshops, asked them, so shall we do that? So we involved some other people, said yes, let's do that. So then our outcomes was that we feel that our identity is something else than they think what our identity is. They say identity is transaction. We think identity is something like a representative of our own activity, of our own morality and our own behavior. So I've made last half year, I was invited in all these environments where these decision makers are. Het strategisch beraad, PPPS, all this kind of, and everywhere I was talking about this, our findings, that these technologies are not based on what citizens want, but what stakeholders want. And they all agree. That's not a problem, that's the strange thing. I was thinking, maybe they would say, no, it's not important. No, they said, yeah, you're right. Yeah, we don't know how to solve this. We have no idea how to solve this. So there is no knowledge and no capacity in the governmental bodies that we have to come up with better solutions for these technologies. And I think Decent shows that it's possible, but then you have to start where you start. You have to start with what people really need, and from there you come to a design and an approach and iterative and agile and all the stuff. So I think you have a design process. You shape the design process, I think, should be in the middle of our democracy. So from where we are now to what we want, it's a long way still. So it's one of the best practices I know about. And I think it's really great it's also European, so that we can share this over our national governments.
Thank you. By the way, you're Marleen Sticker. You
didn't from the Waag Society.
From Waag Society. Reinder?
I run the national petitioning platform, and I recognize a lot of the principles of the Decent project in how I designed it 10 years ago. The morality of the technology choices I made was based on my experiences in 1994 when the digital city was designed here in Amsterdam, which aimed to connect politics with citizens. And in the end, I came up with the petition as an interface between citizens and politics. So indeed, there is at least one instrument you can use to influence politics outside of the election rhythm. And in that sense, the design choices I made are also, in a way, recognizable in the Objective A, the Stonecutter, the Mooncake. It's all in there in a different way, in a very modest way, but already effective for 10 years now. Biggest problem with decentralized tools is that power is central. It's centralized, and get to power, to get into power, you have to centralize. And okay, it's nice to have these democratic tools to run your organization or political party, your citizens' movement in a democratic way. It is very essential or good, but you can also do it in a different way. In the end, you need to get to that. Yeah, that monopoly on violence, the state that can throw you in jail and take your money, that's a monopoly of violence, and they have power. And as citizens in a decentralized way, in a Facebook group or in a forum or something, you're not grabbing the power, you're not influencing. So, for example, if you want to change policy and you react to it once it is rolled out, you're too late. So in that sense, the stone cutter or whatever that notifies you in a very early stage, that's crucial, because otherwise it's dictated to you what's going to happen, and then you're too late because you can only revolt or protest or something like that. And about the discussion, like the big forum or any group discussion between citizens, I completely did away with it. I do not want it on my forum because you create huge differences between, tweedeling, divides between citizens, those who are really good at it, have a lot of time on their hands, the education, and know how to touch type with 10 fingers, and those who actually run alive, don't have time for all this. And in the end, I came up with a solution. Yeah, you can just sign. Sign if you like something, sign if you can identify with that, and then let your voice be heard. You can also donate, and then hire somebody or give your skills to a group that actually proposes a policy, and no group decision making going on there. It is take it or leave it.
Thank you. Mieke van Heeswijk.
Hi, my name is Mieke van Heeswijk. I'm here now because I also work for Network Democracy. I think it's really applaudable that you made a lot of tools which oppose to the Googles and the Facebooks, because that's really needed. It's really needed that Europe takes a stand against those tools at this moment right now. On the other hand, I have the same feeling as Reinder has that, in the Netherlands we had a lot of, G-thousands and citizen participation projects. And I think the real power is somewhere else, and the power is not online, you cannot see it online. It's the power is where people know people, who connects to whom, and it's. I think, for me, transparency is one way to see more in these powers and make it more transparent, so citizens can see what's happening. On the other hand, I still think it's really applaudable that all those tools are there at this moment. And with my experience with Network Democracy, we organized a lot of events. We did a hackathon in the parliament. We created publics and transparency platform. And there were a lot of people interested, and they were there, but almost all the time there were no politicians. They are not interested in those tools at this moment. And we noticed that a lot of people who are working in governments, they are really interested in changing the system, but the politicians at this time are not.
Any politicians in the room, by the way?
Of course not. No.
Don't hide.
No, and we didn't find any, really not any connection with any political party in the Netherlands, except from the Pirate Party, of course, who wanted to talk to Network Democracy on those topics. So I don't know what to do. We have to wait till the elder people are gone and the younger generation is there. I don't know.
Maybe, thank you. When you go for your microphone, then Marleen can just say a word.
Just a response. I think it's clear that the problem is not big enough yet in the Netherlands, but it was in Spain, and it is in Greece. So I think these tools, everything we do is politics, but some of it is party politics, some of it is elected politics, but. The movements that have been described and are active, they use these tools to create their own politics. These are people that were not in politics before. And I think that's a big difference. So if we go to our politicians at the moment, they're part of an old system. And they have to stay in that system. It's very dangerous, it's very disruptive, these new tools. So we have to start outside of the politics, the existing politics, to make it happen. So maybe don't wait for politicians.
One remark. I always say within Network Democracy that the internet takes out all the intermediaries. Isn't politics an intermediary between citizens and the world we want to live in? So maybe in the future we do not really need political parties anymore.
Thank you very much. I'm Paul Suikerbuik. I'm working for the Dutch government as an open data evangelist. I do have a very easy job. I just talk to governments and they open up their data. At least that was my dream. So I run into a couple of problems there, and I really do need to make a lot of discussions with governments to open up their data. But I think we're doing quite well, although it's not enough yet, and it will. I guess it will be never enough whenever. But open data is so fundamentally as an instrument to all kinds of democratic challenges, that everything which is possible should be there as an open data. Although I feel, and that was also my question, is that, that there are also dangerous aspects in technological solutions for democratic challenge, because we do live in a democracy, and we do live in this democracy for years, for hundreds of tens of years, for hundreds of years, in all kinds of democracies. And all these democracies were not based on technology. They were all based on kinds of way how people were interacting with each other. And technology might improve the way people are interacting with each other, but on the basis of all those technologies should be the human interaction, humans working together, humans being together. And I think we are over promising sometimes what technology can do for a democracy in this way. So I really want to talk more about the human aspect of democracy than of the technology side of democracy. The technology is a tool, and it's an important tool. It will include more people into having a democratic discussion, but never ever forget a democracy is about people.
And maybe you can answer then, because how do you think that people should change?
Yeah, but maybe, yeah?
How people are going to change is that the actually, if you go to have a view on old buildings of society, then there was a lot of talking. People were talking, sharing information by just talking to each other. And due to technology, the spread of your word is much, much bigger. There, you can talk to much more people. And that's an important aspect of, but never forget that these aspects are there, and that these aspects are very important for our democracy.
Anybody wants to respond in the panel?
I think your assumptions are wrong. Technology is not just a tool. Technology are cultural artifacts. So if you say we can talk to everybody, well, if you use Facebook, Facebook decides who listens to your stories, because there's an algorithm in between you and your network. So the algorithm actually is an instruction.
But, okay, sorry, I have to interrupt you. Who is deciding here in these platforms who is talking to who? There are also rules. There are always rules.
Exactly, that's my point. So they're cultural rules. So they're these are humans. Those are not acts of God. Mm-hmm. So we need technologies to be explicit about the rules and instructions and algorithms that are inside of them, and we have to learn to understand them. So to see that Facebook algorithms are different than federal algorithms which are in these tools, which also have to be explicit. I mean, I'm not saying that these are not cultural artifacts. They are the same. I mean, they're as Facebook is. But then you can choose. You can say, well, these are more democratic or more human or more decentralized or distributed. So you have to, we have to stop telling people that technology is just technology. It is culture. But it is social. It is law.
But these rules, they should be based on human thinking. And technology will help, but it shouldn't be technology rules. Facebook is relying on technology rules, and that's...
It's based on business models. So the technology is the technology of Facebook and Airbnb and all those are business models. So these are human rules, but people mm-hmm. want to extract information from you to make money out of it.
Okay.
So there are human rules. There are business rules for some people.
But we agree upon the fact that it should be transparent, these rules.
Yes.
Yeah.
There are a couple of things. These things are already happening. Within large commercial organizations, you also have like, okay, how can I reach all my 140, 200,000 employees, etc. This is nothing different other than creating local communities. The only thing that makes Decent also stand apart from all the other existing solutions is that we are trying to create something ourselves instead of going to IBM and asking for a system that can maximize efficiency and reach the exact target audience, etc. And I think that is the chance that we have right here.
Want to answer as well? Yeah.
I have a comment.
I think the lesson I learned in these regards is really that open source is good, but it's not enough. Open data is good, but it's not enough. What I learned from Decent is really that the methodology, because code is becoming so important, that the methodology with which we make code, so literate programming as a methodology becomes very important. So the readability of the code, the verifiability of the code that we write is very important, because all systems are made by humans, but it's very important that humans can read them. And perhaps also not only we are also, let's go beyond the anthropocentric view, because actually sensor data could inform even other living beings into where we go. So this is just a vision. But it has to be, just to put some doubt. It's the next experiment, but it's important, the methodology.
I would even push it more radically than that, that what you're saying is a cultural artifact. I mean, for me, I mean, you have, of course, the business model on top of this platform, which is guiding the development. I mean, if you see something like Uber, what Uber does, I mean, I think it really goes beyond only the rules and the technology they're using. Really, these guys are building the next institutions. I mean, they're like changing labor laws. They're changing what you can do with renting assets. I mean, they're changing, you know, laws around transports and housing. I mean, these are fundamental things about the institutions of society. So we should really stop of thinking technology as something disentangled by, you know, all the rest of the democratic institutions. It is really about building the future institutions. So we shouldn't underestimate this.
Thank you.
The next political institution, Mika already said it, that needs to be rebuilt, I think, is the political party. Also, what your research showed, the examples of Podemos and the Five Star Movement in Italy, the political party, I've been a member of five of them, I've studied them from the inside, this is very interesting, and the existing political parties are not going to change, I agree on that. They're just stuck. And it's. I also follow the Pirate Party closely. Actually, I'm also a member, I think. And to design something from the ground up as a political party is extremely difficult. And also because of this distrust from citizens to these institutions. And in that sense, what I try to do is also to be a parallel, an alternative institution to political parties, but then with a design that is open, transparent, the whole, we agree upon that.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to mention one project. It's called Unwinding Spin Doctors, because we think political parties are old-fashioned, but Unwinding Spin Doctors is a project from IFIR this year, and they're going to monitor the political parties, and the political parties are going to micro-target voters. They're doing it in the States already, but the IFRI is going to monitor it in 2017, how Dutch political parties are micro-targeting voters. So don't forget about political parties in that sense, because they're learning and maybe going to start a bit look like Uber in this sense, yeah.
We come a little bit to the end of this panel. We have a remark here. Can you tell us who you are?
I'm Patrice. I'm the predecessor of Jaromil here. And Jaromil said something that I want to return to. He was saying, code has become so important. And I think somewhere it's the basic of our discussion here. Code has become so important. But if you accept that, if that is your starting point, then you are already in a situation of reaction. You're already in a situation of you are already on the defensive. So maybe we should question, we should start questioning that importance of code in our life and maybe reduce it a bit.
Great remark, we have an answer here.
Yeah, I'm Henk-Jan van Alfa, I'm a researcher for the water sector. I want to respond to your suggestion to change the political party as an institution. I think that's a good idea. But foremost, I want to suggest to change the marketplace as an institution, because the marketplace dominates a kind of interaction that is very much focused on individual choices, so individualism, and very reduced choices to economic benefit. Mm-hmm. And the marketplace is slowly getting into institutions that previously were much more social, like the family, the organization, the local community, Uber, for instance, they're all marketplace-based. So, and there's so much power derived from the marketplace as opposed, for instance, to the political institutions, that maybe that's also a good target to approach.
This is a very good point. This is something I've been struggling with on my petitioning website. Lots of users, they are reasoning from their individual perspective. What do I gain? What do I have to change? And actually, I even heard it through during this presentation, that some voters or citizens, they want their individual interest materialized. And in my design, with the petition as an interface between politics and citizens, they always get an answer. Most petition websites, they don't do that. It's just out there, you complain to the web, and that's it. That's where it ends. I always bring it to the institutions, and the institutions have to supply an answer. And those answers are usually emphasizing, look here, we have a society to run. And there is like a public interest, which is not equal to your individual personal interest. And we have to strike a balance between all of them. And now I hope you can understand that this is the end result, and this is why we have to say no to your petition. And that's, the kind of educating the website is doing by design.
Yeah. Well, I think parallel to what you're bringing with peer-to-peer and blockchain type of thinking in these technologies is also happening in new economic systems based on commons and peer-to-peer. So you see that if you want to change, at the moment politics is based on economic models. So if you propose a specific policy and the economic model doesn't tell you that will give jobs to people and is part of economic growth, then you're dead. So every political party makes it its politics that fits the model. So we have to change the economic model. And I think in the commons movement, there is some possibilities. I mean, I'm not saying that this will be dominant in the coming years, but definitely there are new practices around energy transition, around, so this whole commons transition is part of creating a new relationships based off cooperation instead of competition. And this is the bigger shift that we need. So value creation, we have to rethink value creation. And therefore we have to rethink what makes us tick as humans. So we think we're based on competition, survival of the fittest. But we have to also realize that the best cooperator wins. So and that kind of new thinking about ourselves is much on a deeper level, maybe helps us to trust other systems than the system that we're in at the moment.
Thank you. Final remarks.
I thank you very much, because the last point you made was really the point I also wanted to make, that it's not about technology, but how do people work, how do people interact? I think you made the point also that technology is really important to get this done and to get the real thing working, but the basis should be how people are together.
Thank you. Ahmed, do you have a final word somewhere?
Well, in the light of Decent, we've been arguing and discussing with a couple of European commissions a lot surrounding the amount of money that we actually put into licensing, for example, in this case open source, without any economic activity. We're talking about billions and billions a year over the whole Eurozone. Well, if you can only apply like 10% of the money that we actually spend on licenses in the IT industry here in Europe, would be completely self-sufficient and self-dependent within the Eurozone. And I think that is the next step, and that is something that we need to focus on, not to see like, well, there's a Facebook, well, maybe we can make something better than Facebook. And most technologies, well, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, everyone is using it. Well, that was founded here in the Netherlands. Well, and I think that is also something that we need to focus on.
Thank you very much for the panel. Please give them a big applause here. And with that, we go to the last part, which is Evgeny Morozov. He hardly needs an introduction, I'd say. He's written several very interesting books, The Net Delusion, for example, and also To Save Everything, Click Here. And he'll reflect on the future perspectives of democracy and technology. So please give him a hand.
Well, good evening. if you have followed my work over the last decade, I would say, you probably have seen that I have spent last 10 years attacking virtually everybody and everything under the sun. Fellow technology intellectuals, technology companies, government CEOs, think tanks, members of your family, you name it. You know, as happens with intellectuals, I think I've run out of targets. So I've decided to become this very optimistic techno-utopian transhumanist solutionist who thinks that technology is the answer to all of the world's problems. Of course, I'm just kidding on that last point. Nonetheless, I think I would break my usual routine of complaining about others this time and start with a few words of critique about myself. It's a very rare event. So 3 years ago, I wrote a book called To Save Everything, Click Here, and I'll spare you the painful pages and I'll just summarize the argument. And the argument there was relatively straightforward and simple. Basically, what I argued is that there are a lot of very silly people in California, and they are really trying to solve a lot of problems in a rather silly, stupid, shallow way. That was more or less the crux of it. You know, I've come to revise that view somewhat. I still think that there are a lot of silly people in California, so I haven't really changed my mind on that one. But I think I now realize that I took a somewhat lazy way out of the argument, in that I never really discussed whether the problems that they are trying to solve in very silly ways actually exist or not. I just said that they're trying to do it in a silly manner, which I think ultimately had to do with the intellectual setting in which I wrote that book, which had to do with me being in various, mostly American universities, reading a lot of highly theoretical literature, trying to convince Silicon Valley that, you know, they haven't read John Rawls, Jürgen Habermas, or Heidegger. And I think I just put a little bit too much faith in the ability of Rawls, Habermas, and Heidegger to actually make sense of the contemporary situation. In that, you can perfectly argue that these people haven't read them, but it doesn't at all mean that our current theoretical literature is up to the task of actually making sense of various crises that beset our society today. And I think the goal of my intervention tonight will be to highlight what I take two of these main crises at the current moment to be, and try to maybe highlight how projects like Descent fit into solving those crises, because I think that there are many. And I should say that I'll have to pack it in, you know, 15, 18 minutes, but I'm working on two books right now, one of which has to do with cities and what's happening to them technologically and politically, and one of them has to do with a much more historical argument about the origins of the internet, Silicon Valley, and surveillance capitalism, however you want to put it. So I'll try to put two of those together, but again, it's a very initial and sort of very basic first try with an extended audience of summarizing those two arguments and putting them together. So my basic point today will be that we are facing two rather acute crises when it comes to democracy. One of them has to do with knowledge, expertise, and institutions. This is crisis number one. And crisis number two has to do with the overall inability of the neoliberal economic model to deliver the kinds of results that citizens, especially in Western Europe, expect of it. Technology, I should say, plays a fundamental role in this situation, and this is where you see the more dialectical sort of Evgeny 2.0, in that I'm ready to acknowledge that it can both amplify the worst in the contemporary situation and make this crisis even worse, or used differently and used wisely, it can actually help us at least chart our way towards something of a solution. And this is where I think that projects like Descent, with the right tinkering and when aligned with the right political forces, might actually be of great help and contribution. And I should say that as far as I stand, I think that what we are seeing in Greece, what we have seen in Spain recently with Podemos, what we might be seeing elsewhere in Southern Europe, what we are now seeing with the new movement that Yanis Varoufakis started across Europe, may be the first manifestation of political forces who have become fully aware of these two joint crises that I'm going to talk about. So if you look at the first crisis, the crisis of institutions, knowledge, and expertise, I think it has been sort of well diagnosed by people like Habermas back in the early 70s, where they basically argued the increased complexity of modern society and the introduction of bureaucracy in virtually all domains of everyday and political and social life is going to drain our democracy of its meaning, because you'll end up with a lot of technocrats taking many of the decisions. The situation with a few exceptions, and Holland has actually been quite good in experimenting various participatory models to involve citizens in decisions about science and technology, so it's a good exception. Most exceptions here have been rather bad. Situation has not changed from the early 70s where that diagnosis has been made. I would argue that it has actually become much worse, in part because the ability of average citizen to make sense of what's happening in rather complex domains, whether it's science, whether it's food policy, whether it's environmental policy, has become considerably worse, and not because of factors that are internal to the laws of bureaucratic development, but partly because there are organized political and economic forces that are doing their best to suppress even the circulation of knowledge that citizens can use in order to make sense of the current situation, where we do face the organized production of ignorance by all sorts of neoliberal think tanks, their affiliated media establishments, and so forth. So it almost has become impossible to actually know what we should make of climate change or any of the other global problems, in part because our institutions of producing knowledge have been corrupted themselves, not to mention the funding that goes from the industry to the scholars themselves. Along with that crisis, of course, we have seen something else happening, and that was basically the loss of trust in institutions themselves, right? The loss of trust in political parties as vehicles of promoting interests, whether those were interests of workers or whether those were interests of other organized groups. So those two combined have produced an even more acute crisis of legitimacy for capitalism now that existed back in the early 70s when it was diagnosed. The answer from the neoliberal establishment, which, by the way, never really liked democracy. If you go and read text of Friedrich Hayek, you'll actually see that what matters for the neoliberals is the well-being of the market and not the democratic state, which under certain conditions can actually restrain the market by imposing capital controls, right? So there has always been a slight favor of anti-democracy to the neoliberal project, which you could clearly see in the support that people like Hayek bestowed upon the Pinochet regime in Chile. So this relationship between markets and democracy has always been a rather tricky one, and we have seen it somewhat enter the debate last year in discussions around Greece, where the Greeks were told that it doesn't really matter whom they choose in elections. What matters is what investors expect from the markets. What matters is the well-being of the Eurozone. So you had actually seen that classical neoliberal argument enter the picture as well. So how does the neoliberal project deal with that challenge? I would argue that so far it has dealt with it in many ways, often by denying that the problem exists, a conventional tactic, but also by acknowledging that there are certain gaps in participation that need to be breached somehow. And how are they being breached? Well, they're being breached with the help of information technology, but in a way that treats citizens in a very neoliberal Hayekian manner, mostly as nothing but bags of expertise They're like just bags of facts. And we have to find ways to extract those facts from them, incorporate them into our existing market and political institutions. Thus, the citizens will feel happier because they will at least feel emancipated from all of those oppressive and participatory institutions. And on the other hand, the markets will function better because suddenly you have this hidden reservoir of citizens coming on stage and more or less participating, sharing knowledge, producing data, and so forth. I would argue that if you look at the United States, a lot of the activities that have been pursued by people like Beth Novak, who was the former deputy chief technology officer of the US government, who now leads a think tank called GovLab, they fit this neoliberal, let's talk less and do more, let's collect all the facts from people kind of model. Which I think is actually, if you read it from the perspective of radical democracy, is extremely anti-democratic in that it does not really grant the citizens the ability to change the institutional landscape in which they find themselves. All that's expected from them is some kind of help and assistance. You know, you put, you know, it all started with the patents. So you can have a peer-to-peer, whatever, patent evaluation system where you put the patents online, and then you involve the citizens helping the patent office to figure out which patents exist and which don't. I mean, you can clearly see that even citizens themselves have been now enrolled into supporting the patent system in the United States, which itself is an interesting reflection of the neoliberal project. But the idea there is that you would like to tap into citizens as a reservoir that can actually help you get things done. So a lot of this excitement now in America of getting citizens out of the loop and instead relying on their sensors when it comes to the generation of data, I think it fits that somewhat neoliberal conception of participation. So you want to cut out this unruly people with crazy ideas about getting rid of political parties or scrapping the European Central Bank or, you know, God knows what, and instead rely on much safer systems, which will help us to generate the kind of data that we can use in urban planning or some kind of participatory planning of something else and so forth. And this is where the new infrastructure that is built by Silicon Valley comes in quite handy. And if you read the text by people like Beth Novak, her project is actually conceived as a direct challenge to deliberative democracy, with the argument being that, well, under deliberative democracy, people talk far too much. And we, the pragmatic guys, want to come in and get things done. So we'd like to set up these institutions and platforms that will help us get things done. Right? And where I think projects like Decent fit in is in opening up spaces of contestation that go beyond just this predefined participation, where the only thing you can do is just to produce data on the terms that have already been predefined by the institution that is interested in collecting it, right? And in this case, it can be citizen opinions, it can be service, you know, it can be God knows what. But the idea is that we need to preserve the kind of empty space that has been crucial to radical democracy and conceptions of radical democracy. We do not want to eradicate that emptiness, as a lot of theories of radical democracy have claimed it. And I think a lot of efforts that currently emanate from Washington, Silicon Valley, and all sorts of institutions that they have produced also in Europe, they actually aim to close that empty space and banish it altogether so that we do rely on processes of algorithmic regulation, which in themselves are an effort to institutionalize the complete elimination of this empty space, which makes democracy as a place that's indeterminable, and it's indeterminate, it thrives on uncertainty, right? We want people to come and contest and argue with each other because we don't know what solution works best, right? That, to me, is an ideal conception of democracy. Efforts to foreclose it with all sorts of institutional arrangements, to me, anti-democratic. And this is how I think we should be reading this attempts to install algorithmic regulation, a concept into which I just don't have much time to go into, but I encourage you to look up because ultimately it links with attempts to even make participation post-discursive. Right? Ultimately, that's what it is. You want to leave the stage at which people can actually cognizantly arrive at evaluation of a situation and move to an environment where all that matters from what they do and how they participate is just the data itself. So the cognition and kind of cognitive mapping that they could be doing, that itself is left aside. So this is crisis number one. And I think this is where we have to be careful because the same technologies can be used for a very different legitimization purpose. Crisis number two is different. It has to do, again, with the overall collapse of the socioeconomic model. in Europe, which we used to call the welfare state. Here, again, I can probably talk for 2 hours, so I'll have to cut a lot of corners and just speak very programmatically. But basically what I think has happened is that the European social model had run into problems already in the early 70s, right? And if you go and read bright sociologists like Wolfgang Strick, you will see that various solutions have been designed and devised to tackle it. Right? One of those solutions was to have governments take on more debt. That worked for a while. Then, you know, the idea was to actually shift that burden to citizens. So we entered into an age where we basically citizens themselves have become indebted. There have been various ways that what Strick would say buying time that have been taking place in Europe, essentially to avoid the inevitable. It's to avoid the acknowledgement that something is deeply broken in how our economic system works. I would argue that, miraculously or not, our policymakers, having run out of options, have discovered that there is a very good ally into this new neoliberal hyper-informational capitalism, which will offer them a third way of buying time. And that third way of buying time will basically revolve either around collection and monetization of data the citizens produce, or it will involve direct enrollment of technology companies in offering many services that have been traditionally been offered outside of the market by other kinds of institutions. And this is where, you know, you can easily see how the entrance of companies like Google into areas like healthcare, education, you know, you can also argue that the search was also actually an entrance after libraries have been doing that work for a very long time. You can actually see how the entrance of Silicon Valley into all those domains basically pursued a similar logic. And the logic was that let us collect and aggregate the data. And it'll basically we'll be able to offer you some kind of service that will be a cheaper replacement to what used to be an institution of the welfare state, whether it's medicine, which now will be entirely preemptive, highly individualized, and all revolving around your personal data, or whether it will be education, whether it will be something else, right? And so that was one kind of solution that was found. The problem with this solution is that ultimately it will drain social democracy of any meaning. Because social democracy had always had something of a schizophrenic nature to it, in that, you know, if you look at the social compromise that was struck in Europe after the Second World War, the social compromise was always that it's okay, we can allow some markets in. We are okay to accept that the market form is probably the best one to rule the world, but we'll heavily regulate it. So we'll try to somehow take away the worst consequences of the market logic, and we'll try to compensate them with various institutions built on top of that. But the precondition for that to happen was that citizens couldn't opt out of that deal. That was the precondition, that, you know, you would actually need to go and support your neighbors with the same contributions you would pay for, you know, in taxes or for insurance or for transportation or something else. Everybody was supposed to share the burden more or less equally, because you didn't know the risk profiles and you didn't know which of you was likely to suffer the most. So the welfare state and the social democracy always presupposed a certain attitude from the citizen, and that attitude itself had now come into question for two reasons, so maybe for more, but two are the ones I'll talk about. Reason number one is that constant promotion of neoliberalism by the very same governments had actually convinced quite a lot of people that they are out there for themselves and they have to be looking after themselves and there is no reason why they should be subsidizing others. So people had basically stopped thinking in terms of solidarity and they had stopped thinking in terms of building and sustaining social ties and they started thinking only for themselves, which is a normal consequence of 30 years of neoliberal brainwashing. Factor number two, which I think is very important, is that the digitization of society had made it much easier to identify the conditions under which you need to opt out and drop out of social ties and to actually drop out itself. So if you look at something like Uber, forget about Uber, I'll get to it in a second, but think about the bookshop, right? I mean, 30 years ago, you'd step into a bookshop. There would be no way for you to find out if the books in that bookshop are available anyway, cheaper, so you can actually pay a cheaper price, disappear, and not contribute anything to the cultural industry. Maybe it would be, you'll just go there, you'll just buy the book and disappear. Now you go to a bookshop, there is absolutely no reason for you to pay more. If you're paying more, then you either deeply believe in the importance of bookstores, or you just basically think that, you know, just basically you're an idiot who cannot use a smartphone. Like, those are the two options. Maybe you'll tell me that there are more. In the first condition, maybe it's great that you support the cultural industry, but if you relate it to what I've just said about the hegemony of neoliberal logic, that in itself is not sustainable. You cannot expect people to be self-funding public goods if for 30 years you preach to them that, you know, you should only be thinking about yourself and pay out of everything out of your own pocket. Right? So you basically arrive to the situation where even with Uber, you know, if you're a normal person who doesn't have any problems, you know, you do not have any problems with health, you know, you do not have any disabilities, why should you be subsidizing rides of people who are disabled on Uber? Why should be paying for training to drivers who will be handling disabled passengers? There is no reason whatsoever for you to opt in if you have already opted out of society. And I think what digital technology has done, coupled with the neoliberal logic and neoliberal hegemony, it just has allowed a lot of us to opt out. And I think that that opting out will just, unless there is a political intervention, unless there is a different political and social logic and economic logic put to challenge it, that unraveling will continue even further. And I do not think that social democracy as such actually has a good answer here. Because the compromise that was made, you know, you'll have some markets, so you know, you'll have the regulated taxi industry, we'll have the well-regulated hotel industry, we'll have the well-regulated some other industry. It never worked perfectly. Those industries got corrupt very quickly, and they would still be charging you more for all of the social costs they had to bear than Uber or any of their competitors ever would. So you'll end up in a situation where citizens will need to choose between a much cheaper option of Uber or a much more expensive option of, you know, an existing provider. And my fear is that under the neoliberal paradigm, most of them will opt for Uber, which basically means that social democracy is dead. It's no longer an option. Which, you know, if you're a social democrat, it's bad news. If you're not a social democrat, it's good news. Because, you know, if you're on the radical left, it's great. If you're on the radical right, it's great. And my fear is that the radical right at this point is far better prepared to take advantage of the situation. They have the technology, and they will use the existing technology. They'll use smart contracts, they'll use blockchain, they'll use whatever is under the sun to basically further turn everything into an asset and convince us that by marketizing and financializing everything, we'll actually be able to get a better deal for ourselves. That's the project. It's quite clear where it will go. On the left, there is a scarcity, yet, of alternatives, but I think we have to be clear about what's happening and that there is no reason why an intelligent public transportation system that will not be privatized and will not be charging you €3 for each trip, like London does, or whatever, in London it's probably six, cannot function. Right? We have to be able to design alternatives that are inspired by different logic using all of the same infrastructure. Of course, that is not happening in part because the left is focused on other issues. Other alternative social movements have not emerged yet. So what we end up with are a bunch of prototypes and a bunch of interesting projects happening in cities, because in Europe, that seems to be the scale at which non-neoliberal alternatives to Silicon Valley and sort of hyper-technological capitalism as such as possible. And I think the set fits there like this. It's a way to start thinking about alternative uses to such technologies that, you know, you can actually think outside of the neoliberal box, and you actually have to start with existing processes and works and protests of contestation that are happening in Europe. Because ultimately, I do not see how we can continue pretending that somehow our citizens can take on this ethical burden and sustain social democracy and continue paying taxes and whatnot, while our companies do not. Right? They do not pay taxes, but they also clearly do not play by the same rules. So something is fundamentally broken in the social contract that currently exists in Europe. I think the sooner we realize it, the better. But I think we also have to realize the urgency that the radical right, and you know, it doesn't really need to be the radical right that hates the immigrants, but the hyper-neoliberal right, regardless of their position on immigration and social and cultural issues, is extremely well positioned to take advantage of the infrastructure that has now emerged to virtually turn the entirety of your social life and subjectivity into an asset class. That's what it is. So, yeah, Sorry, I've been talking. So maybe I'll stop. But I think I did okay on time.
So who has the first question?
I'm the harbinger of good news, as they say.
Yeah, exactly. Is there anybody who has a question who wants to pose it? Please do. Alexander, will you tell us who you are?
My name is Alex Blom. I'm from the Dutch Internet Society. So my question to you is, you're saying that the extreme right is better positioned than the left, which sort of, to me, sounds like you're attributing a political color to the neoliberalism marketed society, while I think that it is without political color, and giving it a political color is bestowing too much honor on this movement.
Well, but they, you know, such an intervention is only possible in Holland, where you think you live in post-political society, and you know, with transcended capitalism, and everybody is nice and sharing bikes. So, like, I don't share that position. No. I know, but like, I'm being absolutely so brutal here. So I think Uber is the ultimate consequence and the ultimate border of neoliberal market society. So should I be saying that there are forces on the left that feel excited about this extreme form of precarization for drivers? No, it's a project that has traditionally been associated with libertarian / neoliberal right. I mean, how else can I put it? I mean, yes, there are people on the left who are contesting the dominance of the market. Like, I know it may be news to Holland, but like, yes. Like sort of universal, ubiquitous dominance of the market form and the price form over every other form, it's not universally accepted. And like, it's not accepted by me, and I don't know why I should be pretending that it is. This is why we want to take certain things, maybe housing, which I know is a big issue in Amsterdam with Airbnb, maybe other things, out of the complete, fully liquid market circulation. Like, what's the problem there? I don't see a problem. This is why I think you can go beyond the left and right quite easily, but I think there is something very useful in attributing neoliberalism to the right, and there is something useful in attributing communism to the left. You don't need to buy into both of them, but you know, that political spectrum for me, even though I do come from a probably even worse post-political space, the former Soviet Union, it hasn't been completely erased.
Sorry to contradict you again, but it's denying that the market movement is autonomous.
It doesn't when was it autonomous?
It is autonomous. It is a force in itself that cannot be stopped by political directions. It is an illusion to think that we can stop it. And it is not being promoted. It is a consequence of history.
Well, again, I know you've been trading tulips for a long time, but... I contest that, and I suggest you read, I don't know, Karl Polanyi maybe, to see how it actually is forced upon people. And it's, I mean, if you're going to tell me that all countries out there are just magically signing up to TTIP, TISA, and TPP because it's a force of nature, and there is no multi-million lobbying effort to have them sign up, and there is absolute transparency, you can go and read whatever you want because this is how market forces work, like, no. Well, but I know, but like, you guys have to see a doctor. Like, I mean, how is it my problem?
Okay, we have another question here.
Yeah, I'm Sander Klaus. I'm a professor at Amsterdam University. So I think the reason why right, in your words, right wins over left, is mainly because people are driven by convenience and the asset-based solution is more convenient than trying to put in a lot of effort and mm-hmm. trying to go over the other side. And the question is then, do you think that asset-based society, as you describe it, is a stable form of society, or do you think that cannot be sustainable?
Well, I mean, it's a question that we can test empirically at some point. I mean, I just don't think that the Again, here we'll need to examine very closely the kind of claims that are made by people propagating asset-based society. I mean, if by asset-based society we mean a society where private property is the only form of property that's recognized, then, I mean, with enough force, it can be perfectly sustainable. With enough surveillance, it can be perfectly sustainable. I mean, I don't think that you can avoid crises. The question then becomes how easily and bloodily you can suppress those. If you're asking me just about economics, do I think that attributing property rights to everything is the best way to run the world? No. I think that there are clearly some uses and cases where private property might have its limited uses, and there are others where it clearly wouldn't. And, you know, on things like knowledge, I would actually not be so sure that it's a good way, it's a good idea to run knowledge as an asset and not as, say, a common, which is the word du jour in the radical circles.
So what I'm wondering about is if it goes the asset way, then what you get is an enormous difference between the elite and the rest of society, right? But
we already have it, so
yeah, of course. But it will become worse.
Well, yeah, I think in that sense, you know, I think people, I don't want to be nasty to some people writing books about post-capitalism, but I think we're actually moving to pre-capitalism in some sense, and that, you know, we're moving into society, a lot of people will own a lot of assets. Yeah. We will not own those assets, we'll have to pay them rent for using them, and, you know, and it's a very, and, you know, the demolition and the dissolution of the welfare state as a source of offering some protection is only another sort of evidence point that we are actually rolling back a lot of the achievements that have been made. You know, you can make all sorts of critiques of the welfare state from the left if you want, and many of them are valid. But arguably, you can say that, you know, it was an effort to decommodify the production of health, education, public transportation, and many other services. All of that now swept away, and we're moving to a society where, you know, it's like feudalism. Like, it's not even pre-capitalism.
Yeah. But, even if you are on the wealthy side of the asset-based society, I mean, the only way to increase your wealth even more is by bringing up the rest of society with you, right? Because they need to buy your stuff.
Well, I don't occupy myself with those questions. You know, I think they have enough financial advisors to figure it out.
Can one have more questions from the floor? It's yours. And my question would be to round it off a little bit. It's like, you've painted a rather bleak picture of the actual state of affairs. And you also said that initiatives like Decent can be actually a way forward in some way or another. In how far is this true? If your picture is so bleak, do those projects really help? Or are they just very small drops on a rather dark future that we'll have anyway?
Sure. I mean, look, you have two different models of doing things. You have the sort of Silicon Valley money laundering or venture capitalist model, where you just go and build a startup, get a lot of money from venture capitalists, you fail, you know, they give you another big funding round, then you fail again, and I don't actually know what is being laundered, but a lot of cash changes hands with no attention whatsoever to the actual needs of people. So, you know, you have all the startups building, I don't know, apps to gamify the collection of dog shit and cities, you know, it's like great. Probably a multi-billion industry at this point. I'm not sure they're contesting anything. On the other hand, you have, you know, a different way of doing things, and I think Decent, from what I understand, relies more on the actual needs of movements. And, you know, some of them are more radical, some of them are less radical, but, you know, I have to be blind now to look at what's happening in a country like Spain and to say that, you know, Podemos somehow does not represent the most probably potent challenge to the neoliberal institutional and economic consensus that has existed in Spain since the overthrow of the Franco dictatorship. So in that sense, yeah, they're clearly useful because those tools are being used. You know, everything else, I think you really have to look at what are they trying to do. And if what they're trying to do is to make the work of movements easier, I mean, great, but it much depends on what movements. Like, I don't necessarily want Pegida in Germany using these tools to, you know, organize vote on best ways to, you know, burn housing for the migrants, I mean, or the refugees. So far, I don't see them working with those groups, and I don't necessarily think that Pegida needs one, but again, you have to go case by case.
Suggesting we
Hey, we have, thank you. We have a last question from the floor.
Yes, hello.
Suggest the front door.
My name is Pericles, and I'm going to echo a little bit the question from the professor. Statistics show that less than 50% of voters actually show up to vote.
Yeah.
So that's kind of sad, in my opinion. So from a decent point of view, how are you planning to engage the people and motivate to actually use the platform so it becomes relevant?
Well, I don't work for dissent, so I can give you any Mao's cultural revolution. You know, I can give you all sorts of questions but and answers. But no, look, to be honest, I think a lot of it has to do with people's failure to recognize a political force with which they can actually align themselves. I mean, when you see the photos from events in Madrid or in Barcelona or elsewhere, the occupations of squares, or even the massive referendum support that Syriza won and then somewhat wasted last summer, I mean, I think I would be hard-pressed to say that people are losing interest in democracy. People may be losing interest in establishment political parties, and I don't blame them. You know, the sooner they can delegitimize the system, the better, as far as I'm concerned. Any kind of rightfully thinking, somewhat entrepreneurial political movement would capitalize on that quickly. In different countries, different movements capitalize on it. You know, and that then you have to look at the history of political forces in that particular country to understand which movement is likely to win. I mean, in Spain, clearly, after really harsh financial and housing crisis, and with all sorts of evictions that were happening, really punishing housing law, it was very hard to formulate any sort of neoliberal answer to say that, you know, we vote for our neoliberal party in order to get your houses back. I mean, it would be ridiculous. But again, that situation was very much formed by the local context. So I cannot promise you that people will suddenly see what's happening in Northern Europe, which is anything but the support of the left, but there also the welfare model was the strongest and the role of union is the strongest. It's a tricky, I mean, we can talk for hours, but it's you need to account for the complexity of the local situation. That's the most banal answer I can give you.
Maybe just one comment on this. I think it was very clear also before what Marlene said that, you know, we see a lot of disenfranchisement and this non-voting and passivity when the reference point is a system that is a bit impossible to fix and this kind of dead political system there. And so vis-a-vis to that, a lot of people are disenfranchised and don't go to vote. First of all, we want to go beyond this just voting once every few years. I think it's really important to reimagine the democratic form. And I mean, what we've seen actually in a lot of the decent experiments, in particular in Spain, is an excess of democracy. And what is not ready for that excess of democracy and collaboration and political action is the system. So the system is not ready. So if you see actually the response most of the time is, you know, a defensive response because our institutions are not able to basically accommodate this request of change, this request of more accountability, transparency, and more participation. So I do really think this is a system change. And I do have to say one thing, I'm particularly frustrated. I mean, I understand the emphasis of neoliberalism and the financial crisis is very important. I'm frustrated with the left and the right debate. So if you take it into the decent, really, experiment and the what we're doing, this is really beyond the left and the right. I mean, this has been very much a debate about elites and the people. And all the time, this is really empowering citizens and the people against the kind of corrupted political elites. This is the situation we are having now. So actually, a lot of the recipes for what is not working have been a kind of very well established, have been working very nicely to the right and to the left to create the system we have today. So I think really have to go beyond that, and I think political movements and citizen movement and like Podemos as well, but not only really, are showing that there is a need of a new vocabulary that goes beyond the left and the right and think about inequalities and changing the political model and the economic system to really have some system change.
Wow, okay. Thank you. With that, please give Evgeny a warm hand as well, because he was, thank you. We have come to the end of this evening. I would like to thank all of the speakers, of course, very much. All of the panelists, very much. All of the question bearers that were so brave to ask questions, which is not a small thing to do. So thank you very much for that as well. I would also like to thank the people behind the floors, which you never see. But without them, these things would never happen, actually. It's Christine van den Hoorn who's standing there. It's Tessel van Leeuwen who hides herself below that. Yes, actually, thank you. It's Helen Vermaete, it's Sam van Westen, it's Yvonne Jansen-Dinks who couldn't make it here, and it's also Jaromil because he made it possible for the whole group to come here. So thank you very much again. Oh, of course, and the people that are filming to make it happen for the future, yes, of course. And then finally, thank you to the audience because, frankly, it wouldn't have been the same without you. Thank you very much.
Ik kan het niet lekker misschien ook de zaal beter.